Hi, I'm Jack Savoretti, and I'm here at Abbey Road recording my brand new album. Well, 2 years ago, I should start by that, I discovered that the best way to make an album is do it in 10 days. Don't overthink it, don't overplay it, don't overprepare for it. And we did that in Rome, and we did it at Ennio Morricone studio, and we really wanted to sort of not match it, but excel from it, because we realized that where you make a record is so important. It's like the 12th man on the pitch in a football game. And so it didn't take me long when I was thinking, how do we go up from that? And there was only one place, it was Abbey Road. And I didn't really think we were gonna make it was gonna be possible, but the world has experienced some pretty strange things this year. And due to that, it actually was possible because it did become available. We managed to all do it in the right way and be here safe beforehand to prepare for it. And we've kind of been living in a bubble now doing this. But we decided 10 days in Abbey Road is probably the best way for us to make an album better than the last one. And I hope we might have just gone and done it. So we're in a pretty good spirits right now. No, I mean, first of all, I don't know if I would define it as stressful. It's no messing around, which is what I like, because I've had so many experiences. You know, this is going to be, my seventh album. I've actually even lost track. But I've had so many experiences where you can really lose a day, and you can lose a song by indulging in it, by diving into perfection or searching for a perfection that rarely is found, if ever. So I love I don't want it to be perfect. I just want it to be something that we can't explain. And I work with the most unbelievable technicians and musicians that can pretty much explain anything. So the only upper hand I get with them is to try to convince them to just do something that they still haven't understood, and to use something that they still haven't understood. So before they can dissect it and either perfect it or not, it's sort of like they're all geniuses at capturing a moment. And that's what I want from all of these guys. Rather than perfecting a moment, I love how they capture moments. And especially when the moment happens to be in the greatest studio on the planet, which gives back so much. I didn't know if it would sort of not live up to its expectation, but man, we're never gonna forget making a record in this room.
We recently had Joe Bonamassa doing Studio One, and he did the whole of his last album Royalty in Studio One and Two, and he was just saying being in this place just completely managed to lift his performance.
Yeah.
Do you feel that's happened here as well?
I feel like that's definitely happened to the band. I think the band has definitely grown up. I haven't really done much, if I'm totally honest. I've kind of been the cheerleader, and like we say that me and Cam Blackwood, we're kind of like the cheerleaders and the movie directors who are here just trying to let everybody do what they do and just make sure that it's guided into the right direction. But I've definitely watched everybody in here walk in as fans, as real sort of, you know, it's definitely gone back into, I've seen little boys walk into this room. I've seen men come into the building and little boys sort of walk into the room, and just, you know, there's a respect. You don't mess around in here, you know. It's like playing football in a certain stadium. It's like anything. I think, you know, the surroundings do matter. Where you make music does matter. And this is one of those places that has such a strong history that when you come in here, what you do has to matter. I don't know how my sound has evolved. I've evolved, as I always hope that whenever we make a record, I don't want to make a record just for the sake of making a record. I want to make it to show that I've discovered new things about music that I love, new things about life that I love, and I've discovered new people to do it with that are going to bring that out. And I think that more than anything, the people I work with have just gotten better and better and better, because I mean, so many have been with me since the first album, but we as a team just kind of keep bringing people in that are going to make us better, and the family keeps growing. And I think you can hear that in every record. You can hear there's a new player. It's always an addition. It's not necessarily somebody leaving and going. It's just an addition. We keep trying to bring more to the team to make all of us better. And the guys up there, both at the desk and behind the instruments, it's been overwhelming to see the masterclass that they've shown me in the last 10 days. And I think the location has a lot to do with it. They wouldn't dare come in here and just do their job. They've all come in here and lived out their dream. Like, that's what people do here. And I can safely say I will reap the benefit of that, because the album sounds the way it does and I'm so proud of it, whatever it does, we can definitely walk out of the studio and say we gave it our best when we came out of Abbey Road. So that's going to be cool to listen back to.
That's what you want to be able to say.
Yeah. And we can definitely all say that. And I think more than anything, I always say to them when we go into the studio, just let's make sure that whatever happens in 10 years, we can sit around a dinner table and all go, remember that album we made in Rome, remember that album we made in Abbey Road, remember that album. And so far, yeah, I think we're going to be really happy with what we've done. Yeah, my writing process this time was particular because of the way the world was. There was lockdown, so I had a lot of time to write. I wrote a lot, and I wrote a lot thinking about, it's one of the few times, well, I should say the last album I did was the first time I wrote thinking of an album. The same, I thought of it like a film, and this is the second time I've done that. But the difference this time was I wrote an album that I knew my guys could play. Oh, I tried to write it to what I think they are really good at. So my stuff is all, I write very simple. It's pretty much, you know, it's like coloring in with crayons, and then I give it to these guys and they throw their magic, their art, their painting. They turn it into what I like to, what I consider at least a masterpiece. I just hand them in sort of a scribble and an idea of it. But this time I was really aware of what my guys can do, and I was really aware, and they were really aware of what I wanted, which was to really touch base with European music, the European music that I was influenced by so strongly. And I think the combination of my European heritage, because I'm half Italian, half English, so I have a very strong attachment to everything that was British and English, especially musically, but I have a super strong influence about everything Italian, French, and Spanish, because I grew up listening to that music when I was a kid. And so in this writing process, these two worlds have collided. And it's amazing because we've got Danish, Italian in here, and mixed sort of people from around Europe coming into the most English location you could possibly get. And I think that contrast is, that combination, should I say, is a winning combination. Yeah, I try to, when I write, I don't want it to, I spent a lot of my 20s writing about how unfair felt, you know, as you are in your 20s, you've kind of got your knuckles clenched for most of your 20s, you know, until they go white, and you sort of can't take any more. And that's usually when I wrote, when I couldn't hold my fists anymore and just wanted to let it all out. That's changed for me. I've, in my 30s, I've found love, I found family, I found a lot more peace. So I've been able to observe rather than to feel everything, or to at least think that I was feeling everything. And through observing, I've started to feel more, a lot more than when I was just running headfirst against everything. So I think in the songwriting, you'll hear that, because I try to visualize a character, not necessarily myself. Unfortunately, I have a pretty rubbish imagination, so most of what I write about has happened to either me or some, or I've witnessed it. But I don't really want it to be a Dear Diary anymore. And the last album is where I started this, and this album as well. I really think of it as a film with scenes, and I want it to be an experience when you listen to a record. I don't want it to be about one particular song. I don't even want it to be just about the music. I want it to be about the culture that is wrapped up in the sound, in the storytelling, in the orchestration. The sound of a drum can take you straight back to sort of France, 1973. The way a bass feels can take you to a certain soundtrack of a Fellini movie. And I want you to keep, like, if you walk into a really good restaurant, you can just smell the stuff. That's how I want you to feel when you listen to the record. Like, oh my goodness, what is that? Like, you can't wait to see what's gonna come out of the kitchen. I want people to feel that when they listen to this album, that you can't wait for the next song, because it's like, ooh, what's up? That was delicious, what's up next? I want people to feel the same way when they listen to the record. Lockdown had an initial effect that I think it had on anybody, where I was sort of sat at the piano in despair, and there was a lot of songs about loneliness and freedom, and but not freedom, there was fear, anxiety and all that, and I just immediately sort of scrunched them all up and threw them away, because I don't think the world is necessarily going to need reminding about what it's been through in 2020. And there's little bits of it will seep into some of the sort of more thoughtful songs of the album, but I really wanted to make an album that celebrated life again, that made you want to dance with the person you love, dance with a group of friends that you love. And it's actually quite, it's definitely the most uplifting record I've ever made. It's definitely the most uplifting I've ever felt. I think it was a bit of an epiphany moment for me to be at home so much, which is such a luxury for me. to be with my children, to be with my wife, to be at home, which is somewhere that I've never really had growing up, that specific. I've felt at home in many different places, but an actual home itself, like a proper physical home that I know every corner of, is quite new to me. And I've been celebrating it rather than bemoaning it or despairing about what is happening to the world. And what's so wonderful is sort of it's come to this climax where we are now here in this historical place making this record. And all that positivity is kind of coming together with all of us. And the world seems to be, touch wood, more hopeful. You know, we've witnessed the change of the United States of America while we were here. You know, I got to announce on the speakerphone that the world is changing and that Donald Trump should be going home soon. And that has lifted spirits here for us. Not for everybody, and fair enough, but for us in here, it has lifted spirits. It gave us all a sense of hope, and just the rhetoric is changing. And it was just lovely for that all to sort of come together while we were here making this album. So, yeah, this is kind of, this record is definitely being in a traumatic situation and looking up. Rather than looking inwards or looking down or fearing the future, it's just about looking up. And I hope when you hear this record, it really is triumphant. And yeah, and it gives you the sense of an epiphany that, you know, there's so much to reach for. I don't think I have any tips that are different from before. It's a really tough time. And it's been tough for myself. It's been tough for my crew, for my band, especially crews around the country to look for a light at the end of the tunnel. There is one, but it's hard to see it. You know, it's been a long time for us. And you know, this is also, everybody in this industry who works in this industry does have this mentality of you have to keep moving. That's kind of why we do it. We don't want to stay still. Music in itself is something that keeps you moving. And the industry around it is very much like that. It's not a static industry. It's not every day is different. So if you're starting out, approach it the same way I would have suggested to anybody 2 years ago, pre 2020, let's call it, rather than mentioning horrible things. Let's just say pre-2020, I would have said the same thing, which is keep moving. Keep making, like, nobody's going to come and get you. Nobody's going to come and find you. Like, go looking for what you want. And only by looking for that will you really, truly know what you don't want. Because you might think you don't want certain things. You might think you do want other things. You just don't know until you get there. And it's really surprising what you do end up saying, oh my God, I love doing that, actually. Why did I pretend I didn't, or why did I do that? Because I didn't want to let anybody know that that's what I like to do. To find your true reason for doing this, because if you're BSing your way through it, nobody's going to buy it. So it takes a while. It took me 6 records to figure it out, to be honest. I mean, I can safely say the last record, I mean, it's been happening for a while, but the last record was the first time I really sort of found that space. I don't know if no one would expect it, because I mean, people who know me well will not be surprised by it at all. But we've been joking, we've been sort of talking about making t-shirts that say "Make Julio Great Again." We've been listening to a lot of Julio Iglesias up in the studio, because yeah, there's the productions of those 70s Julio Iglesias records are unbelievable. And it's something that I grew up listening to very much as a kid, not by choice, by staying up with my parents or by falling asleep in bars while my parents danced on tables. And it was kind of the background of some of my greatest memories. And again, I've gotten to an age or a point in my life where I'm okay with revisiting those memories, and I'm okay with acknowledging, holy crap, this stuff is amazing. And I highly recommend anybody to just take a moment and revisit a bit of old Julio Iglesias, because it's a guilty pleasure I am no longer guilty about at all.
Was it an inspiration at all for this record?
100%. You're going to hear a lot of it. We joke that the sort of the two albums that have been kind of clashing together has been The Weeknd and Julio Iglesias. And it's incredible how much Julio Iglesias is in The Weeknd, if you listen carefully. And also vocally, performance-wise, I've just indulged in what I call Europiana, which is the sound of European music that has been such an influence on so much popular music for the last 30 years.